Hi everyone, it's MJ, and in this video, I want to talk about how to manage market risk. Now, essentially, there is this one idea that, okay, if you've got market risk, you simply transfer a portion that you're uncomfortable with holding using a derivative, or you can reduce a portion with hedging. But it's important that when we look at these two standard approaches to measuring market risk, that we understand a little bit of their drawbacks. The first thing is that when we transfer a portion or reduce a portion with hedging or derivatives, we're losing upside as well. Even with a call option, by paying for that premium, you're sacrificing some of your upside potential. Also important to know that derivatives, they can get quite nasty, they can get very confusing, and because of this, they become complicated and there's now an operational risk of making mistakes. Also, what I think students don't necessarily understand is that we have this thing called basis risk. And this basis risk is the idea that sometimes the right instrument that we're looking for, the right strategy that we want to play, doesn't exist on the market. If you've got some strange asset and you're like, oh, I'll just transfer it with a call or a put option, well, hold on, maybe that's not actually going to be on the market. And this tends to happen, let's say, if you're trading in, say, Africa and you're buying some African stocks, you're not going to have the array of derivatives that you do whether you're investing, say, in America on, you know, the Standard & Poor, looking at the top 500 companies there. So that's also something to appreciate with managing market risk is basis risk. Sometimes you have to use a different strategy that's not actually perfect, and that's going to leave you still exposed. Then derivatives are not a sure thing. There is this counterparty risk. There is this probability that the other party is unable to pay. And in that movie, The Big Short, that was that whole discussion that they were having towards the end, where the team were really convincing their manager to say, close out the positions, close out the positions. And he's saying, no, every day I wait, they're going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. And they said, yes, the payoff might get bigger and bigger and bigger, but they're getting so large that we're actually incurring counterparty risk. There's a probability that these banks themselves could fail and take down all the derivatives with them. Think about it. Lehman Brothers, Bear Stearns, when they failed, those derivatives weren't fully paid out. They needed a bailout, and it was a very complicated thing. So very important to understand the limitations of the two more popular managing market risk strategies. Sometimes the exam will even say to you, how do you deal with this market risk if you can't transfer and you can't use hedging? And that's what we're going to come and talk about in this video. The one thing we can do, and this is very much when it comes to managing risk, link it up with the dimensions of risk and see how each dimension you can control the uncertainty. So, for instance, the one thing you can do is you can reduce the risk duration by either selling earlier or entering into a shorter period contract. So you can use swaps to change the duration, and not necessarily just, you know, the payoffs or the severity. You can also use these derivatives to help you with your duration, but you can also just sell stocks. If you want to get rid of market risk, instead of holding them for a year, you can hold them for 6 months. You've effectively reduced the duration. Of course, we want market risk because it tends to pay out in the long run. So sometimes we might look at ways to increase duration. Then there's another way of reducing frequency. And if you're worried about, oh, you know, when I'm buying shares, the price is constantly fluctuating, and, you know, how's this going to affect my solvency ratio? Then one strategy might be to say, well, instead of buying shares on the public stock exchange, I'm rather going to buy them privately. So either private equity, private debt, private property. And by not buying it on the market, there's not going to be this constant evaluations that might, you know, threaten my solvency ratio. But it is important that if you do that method, you are going to lose a little bit of marketability, because it is harder to sell things privately than it is to sell them on a public market. And this is also an idea that I want to put forward to everyone, is that whenever you manage a risk, there's either a residual risk or there's a cost to doing it. So you do get rewarded for taking on risk. And by managing risks, you are going to incur a little bit of a penalty. But in the exam, it's important that you're able to come up with all these different ideas, as well as highlight the drawbacks of each of them. Now, we can also reduce severity by buying assets that have traditionally had a low volatility, although the drawback here is just because something had a low volatility in the past doesn't mean it's going to continuously have a low volatility in the future. This is something that we're finding out with, say, the corona and the pandemic, is a lot of shares that were very stable have suddenly become very, very crazy. But in normal market conditions, you can maybe get away with saying, well, it's less riskier to buy a share with a very low volatility than one that has had a very high volatility in the previous year, because they do tend to follow a little bit of a change, unless, like I say, with the coronavirus, it's been a systemic shock, it's a natural disaster, it's a world emergency, so of course that is going to make things a lot crazier. Managing market risk, another common idea is to use diversification. Sometimes this is even in part of like these ones over here. It's like one of the main things people say is like, oh, just use diversification. Long-term capital management, they were famous for getting like 40% returns and all of these things, and they didn't want to manage their market risk because of, you know, fear of losing the upside. So they thought that they could get away with managing market risk simply by using diversification, buying a whole bunch of different assets. Now, the idea here is that if correlation is low, it is going to reduce severity. However, when the market starts to panic, correlations increase. This is why we now use copulas. What happened with long-term capital? Russia defaulted on their bonds, which they didn't think they were going to do. The Thai currency became incredibly unstable. There was a lot of panic in the mid-90s, and it kind of wiped out their positions because they didn't have the liquidity to keep topping up their margin calls because they were using leverage, because they were so sure of their trading strategy and they thought diversification was going to help them get through all the pain, and it didn't. So it's a good case study is to look at long-term capital management and how simply using diversification can fail you. So also know that there are the drawbacks of diversification. Another thing that you can talk about with diversification, which often isn't mentioned, is that when it comes to buying and selling investments and assets, you need a lot of specialties. Like if you're buying shares, you need to know what those companies are doing. You need to have a little bit of fundamental knowledge. Now, if you start diversifying, so you start not just buying, say, Apple and Amazon and Facebook and the tech stocks, but you also start buying Boeing and a few of the other, you know, airline things, then you need that additional information in order to understand those markets. So if you're a single team or if you're a small team, diversification might not necessarily be possible. So in order to enact diversification properly, you might need to hire additional staff. Hiring more staff is going to add to expenses. It's going to increase operational risk. You're going to have to provide more oversight. So diversification, once again, is not the silver bullet that it's made out to be, specifically in the earlier actuarial subject. So it's a very, very important thing to understand are the limitations of diversification. Then this last one is interesting, is what we can also do is we can reduce the required capital, okay, through leveraging. But this is interesting because what we're doing is we're reducing one risk dimension, but we're going to increase another risk dimension. So by reducing the amount of capital you need, you're going to increase your severity. And again, this is what long-term capital management were doing, is they said, well, we're quite happy to take on severity because if market risk over the long term has got a positive trend, then yeah, let's do that. Let's reduce the amount of capital we need in order to capture more gains. And it worked well for them for the first 2 years. Like I said, 40% return. But when the crazy market came and there was panic and there was extreme volatilities, they had to close out their positions because they didn't have enough capital. And what they were doing is they were leveraging. And one of the things that you can do today is you can enter into something called a CFD, or a contract for difference, where essentially you don't buy the share because you want to be an owner and enjoy the returns of it for the long term. Instead, you're like, I think the share is going to go up 10% in the next week. Instead of being an owner, I'm going to effectively place a bet. It's a gamble. It's a speculative instrument that says if it goes up 10%, I want a payout of times 100. Of course, if it goes down 10%, I'm going to pay out times 100, and that could absolutely wipe out my margin call. But it does allow you to get more exposure while requiring less capital. So these are the different or alternative ways of managing market risk. And the trick here is to look at each dimension of the risk and say, okay, how can I control the uncertainty within each of these dimensions? And that, in a nutshell, is managing market risk.